Church, I got here this morning about 5:45. Already had a pot of coffee. Forgot my water in the back. We're good to go. Very first thing I want to do is first of all, I'll tell you that the real reason we're up here is this is a sweating contest, so you can sweat the most. And so far I'm winning. I've already gone through my undershirt and I'm working on this one. So.
I'm not quite that far.
I don't even think you've dropped yet. First thing I want to do is ask Jonah just a few questions. If you don't know who Jonah is, he's one of the seniors that received a Bible down there today, but I'm just going to ask him a few questions about kind of how high school was and how what the future looks like, I guess, to introduce our topic for today. And so, first question, Jonah, is after you graduate, you know, in like 4 hours, what are your plans? What do you got planned for the next couple years, couple months?
Well, the summer I'm working at Polk County Conservation at Thomas Mitchell, and then in the fall I'll be going to DMAC for environmental science, and then after DMAC I'm planning on going to ISU, and I think I want to be a wildlife biologist, but that is to be determined as well.
Okay, so as far as the church goes, what about some plans there? How do you plan to stay involved? Do you plan on staying involved at Rising Sun, or do you plan on plugging in at a...
Well, I'll be living at home in the fall, well, the next 2 years, going to DMAC. So I'm still planning on going here. And the new people I meet at college, I plan to continue inviting people to church because I'm pretty good at that.
Humbly perfect.
Yeah.
Good. Good. So tell me about some obstacles, something from high school, from before today, before graduation, for all the other high schoolers. What's something that's kind of been in your way a little bit, something that you have had to deal with?
A lot of times in high school, it's hard to talk about Jesus because we're not supposed to. It's against the rules to bring Jesus into school, but... I know we talked about that a little bit in Sunday school. I don't know if it was last semester or last year. Ways we can reach out to people in school. And a lot of people get offended, but I know a lot of us in high school, we try to still reach out to people and tell them about Jesus as best we can, but that was definitely an obstacle.
Right. So what about after? What do you foresee happening in your obstacles? Is there... when you get to college, you think there's going to be more freedom, maybe not as much, and being able to share?
I think it'll probably be tougher because so many people are going to get persuaded by professors and a lot of that because they harp on like, well, I guess against what we believe.
Sure.
A lot of professors. So I think it'll be harder.
Sure. Yeah. So I asked Jonah if he would come up and preach with me today. And I asked him that, I think, on Monday.
Yeah.
So he's had a lot of time to work on it. And I said, hey, Jonah, I've got a big job for you. And the response I got was, or I asked him, I said, I got a big job, are you ready? And the text was just, IDK if I am. And so then then I was like, no, it's really not that big a deal. I think you'll really like it, what I've got planned for you. And so he said, all right, hit me. And I said, I need you to preach with me on Sunday. And I don't even remember the response, but it was something just, oh boy, or something like that. And but I talked him into it, and I'm glad that he's up here with me. So we're talking about obstacles and things that, you know, we've had to deal with. And just an encouragement for you is... whenever I was in that stage, I guess, going into college and just starting college, it was probably the most difficult thing for me going, and I went to Bible college, and I think because that was the most difficult thing is that I was a lot better at evangelism, I was a lot better at reaching out when I wasn't in Bible college, and whenever I wasn't on staff at a church. That's one of the most difficult things, I think, for me even now here,
yeah.
Is that... that I don't have that outside involvement as much as you will. And so so definitely be encouraged by that. But I want to tell you a little bit about a plan that I once had. We all have different kinds of plans. We've got good plans, we've got other plans. And so this plan happened to be when I was in high school. I think I was, it was either my junior or senior, it was my junior year, because I'll get there in a second. I golfed in high school. I really like golf. I don't make enough money to golf now. Golf's expensive. Like, it's not as expensive when your parents are paying for it. But now it is. So, I mean, if you're not a doctor, you're not a golfer. So I golfed in high school. I went to state for the first time my junior year. And I had went through districts and sectionals playing really well. And thinking, okay, I've got a shot at maybe being like top 10, maybe doing really well while I'm here at state golf. And so I go into state golf with that mindset, and we're there like a day, maybe 2 days before it's supposed to start. And I had these warts on my hand when I was in high school, and there was like two or three of them, and they were right here. And I worked for all of high school trying to get rid of these things, and I just couldn't figure it out. And so we go to the doctor, and she's like, well, we'll just take care of it right now. And so she like has this, I don't know, she's trying to make a high schooler cry is what she's doing. And she just starts digging into my hand with this thing and digs them out and then freezes them and uses some kind of hot thing on them too. And so I'm like in tears and it hurts so bad, and she wraps it up. And so I go to state golf with a big old wrapped up hand. And so my expectations, you know, dropped a little bit, but I'm thinking, yeah, maybe top 20 or so. And I thought pretty highly of myself then. And so at state golf, very first day, very first nine holes, I figured out that I couldn't even swing a club with two hands because my right hand was completely just, it was wrapped up. I couldn't grip the club. It hurt so bad I couldn't like hold on to it. And so I had this plan to go on and be really good at state and be like, oh yeah, this is like a poster child for the high school golf team. And it didn't happen. My plan was kind of ruined. And so my very first shot off the tee went into the pond, but it was about 2 feet into the bank or so. And so I just went down there and hit it out of the pond. And I didn't belong there anyways, because I mean, I don't know how many times I heard like, why is this kid golfing in bib overalls? And these kids, let me tell you, like these kids are serious about their golf. They really are. I'm trying to crack jokes the whole time, and they're like, what are you doing? I'm trying to play. Have you ever golfed before? I'm like, I guess not here. So it was really just not a good time. I went my senior year also, and again, didn't do great. But that was because of me, not because of my hand. But it's in those times that you really feel like you're subject to frustration, like eternally. And you don't really see past where you're at now. And you get in this point where you just really feel like the whole world is against you. You do. So last night, I was grilling, and I went to put some brats on the grill. So I put them on, and I had the grill on low, no big deal. And I go inside, completely forget about them. And I go outside, and the grill is flaming up. And it's like, I mean, it's like coming up over the lid, and I'm thinking, oh my word, these are going to be delicious now. And so I open the lid, and these things are shriveled up, and they're like little smokies. They're like this long, and they're completely black. And like, you had to be careful putting them on the plate so you didn't break the plate. They were rock solid. We ate them anyways. But yeah, it's those little things. Little things keep adding up and keep adding up that make you feel like everything's against you. Why can't I do anything right? And so we're looking through the Bible, looking through the book of Romans, actually, is what we're going to be today. And we see, it talks about this. It talks about how, like, you feel when the whole world is against you, how you feel like you're subject to frustration. And so Jonah's going to go ahead and talk a little bit about that, about Romans chapter 8, if you got your Bible, why don't you open there? It's right before Acts. Right after Acts, sorry. Before the rest of the New Testament.
So if you turn with me, we're going to start in verse 18. I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that is to be revealed in us. The creation waits in eager expectation for the sons of God to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to frustration, not by its own choice, but by the will of the one who subjected it. And we've all gone through frustration in our lives, and we have these big plans to do great things. Like recently, we were planning a spring break trip for our senior year, me and a couple of buddies, and okay, that's fine, since you forgot yours. Mm-hmm. So we planned extensively for this trip to go to Kansas, and we picked out a few lakes in southeast Kansas where it looked like we'd have some success catching some bass, and we were just going to go down there and pond hop, or lake hop, and in camp, and just go into town and eat at night and stuff. And we're checking out the forecast, and like the week leading up, it was looking pretty good, like sunny and 75. Well, we get to a couple days out, and the forecast wasn't looking so good for us. But we thought, you know, we're tough guys. We're young kids. We can tough the cold, like
indestructible seniors.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Nothing can hurt us. Well, the first day, it really wasn't that bad. We caught a couple fish. It was sunny. And then that night, the sun kind of went away. The temperature started dropping, and the Kansas wind started picking up. And we started to get a little nervous. We ended up camping that night. I think the low was 25. It was a little rough. We started a little fire.
The tent.
Yeah. No. We did the best we could. And we wake up the next day, and after that, I don't think we saw the sun till the last day. And what we thought was going to be a fun trip with nice weather, we specifically thought we'd go to Kansas to be warm, because it was cold in Iowa at spring break. And we get down there, and we had to endure highs in the 40s, lows in the 20s. And it was pretty rough on us. And three 18-year-old boys stuck on a boat for most of the day. And freezing cold, you can imagine the temper started to rise. But we tried our best to get through it, and on the last, well, no, it wasn't the last day. It was probably second to last day. One of us finally caught our first fish. And when we thought it couldn't get much worse, we're sitting on Wilson Lake, and I forgot what town that was near. Southeast Kansas, middle of nowhere. When we thought it couldn't get any worse, it started snowing on us. Spring break. It was pretty rough.
Hey, one fish a day keeps the smiles away.
Oh, something like that.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And you see, we make these elaborate plans to have fun and do stuff, and sometimes it just ends up in frustration because it didn't go our way. And then in verse 21 it states, "In hope that creation will be liberated from its bondage to decay and brought into the glorious freedom of the children of God." And because Adam and Eve ate the fruit, forever creation is going to be subjected to frustration in all of our lives and whatever we do. And so in 21, Paul throws in that because creation was made to, well, has to struggle, God is going to liberate us from the earth. And our scenarios aren't as serious as explained in like verse 18. And none of these struggles compare to the glory that is going to be revealed in us through our frustration.
So why don't you go ahead and read 22 through 30, and just kind of set us up for where we're going to be today. The actual text of what we're going to look through is 31 through 39, but to give us some background on kind of where we're at, why don't you go ahead and read that?
Okay, so we're going to start in verse 22. "We know that the whole creation has been groaning as the pains of childbirth right up to the present time. Not only so, but we ourselves who have the first fruits of the Spirit groan inwardly as we wait eagerly for our adoption as sons, the redemption of our bodies. For in this hope we were saved. But hope is seen in no hope at all. Who hopes for what he already has? But if we hope for what we do not yet have, we wait impatiently. In the same way, the Spirit helps us in our weakness. We do not know what we ought to pray for, but the Spirit himself intercedes us for the groans that words cannot express. And he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for the saints in accordance with God's will." And we know that in all these things, God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. For those God foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the likeness of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those who are predestined, he also called. Those he called, he also justified. Those he justified, he also glorified.
Good. So as we look through that, we see these present sufferings, all these nasty things that we have to go through. What we talked about really isn't that big of a deal, but some of them are, and we have something to look forward to. And then you get to verse 31, and Paul writes, "What then shall we say in response to these things?" And these things, I think what he's talking about is all the way from the beginning of chapter 5. He's talking about all these different different blessings and everything that go along with God's part of salvation for man. And so I think that's what's leading up to this. What then shall we say in response to these things all the way since then? If God is for us, who can be against us? I think it's interesting to think that even as Christians, as people who believe in Jesus, who believe the things that we believe, that we still have adversaries. We still have people that are out there against us. They really are. Nothing's going to stand against God, and we're going to talk about that here in a little bit. But it's interesting to think that we do have adversaries. We do have people that would consider us their enemies. I would like it to say, since God is for us, instead of if, because he really is. He's for us. He's on our side. We just read a little bit ago, as we know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him, him, the believers. He goes on to say, "He who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, how will he not also, along with him, graciously give us all things?" If you've got a Bible, this one's, none of the scriptures are on the screen, just what you see right there, but go ahead and turn to Genesis chapter 22. Genesis chapter 22, and as you're turning there, you're going to figure out that it's the story of Abraham and Isaac. The language that Paul uses here is almost a little bit of the same thing with the son. And so let's read chapter 22. "Sometime later, God tested Abraham. He said to him, 'Abraham, here I am,' he replied. And then God said, 'Take your son, your only son, whom you love, Isaac, and go to the region of Moriah. Sacrifice him there as a burnt offering on a mountain that I will show you.'" So Abraham's only son, Isaac. And keep in mind all of the stuff. You can go back and look before this and after we're done, but all the things that Abraham went through and how long he had to hope for a son, how long he went without having a son, knowing that promise was coming. And early the next morning, Abraham got up and loaded his donkey. He took him with him. He took with him two of his servants and his son Isaac. When he had cut enough wood for the burnt offering, he set out for the place God had told him about. On the third day, Abraham looked up and saw a place in the distance. He said to his servants, "Stay here with the donkey while I and the boy go over there." So at this point, Abraham knows that this is the mountain. This is the mountain that God was saying. "Stay here with the donkey, I'll go, and the boy go over there. We will worship, and then we'll come back to you." Abraham took the wood, the burnt offering, placed it on his son Isaac, and he himself carried the fire and the knife. As the two of them went on together, Isaac spoke up and said to his father Abraham, "Father." "Yes, my son," Abraham replied. "The fire and wood are here," Isaac said, "but where is the lamb for the burnt offering?" And Abraham answered, "God himself will provide the lamb for the burnt offering, my son." And the two of them went on together. When they reached the place God had told him about, Abraham built an altar there and arranged the wood on it. He bound his son Isaac and laid him on the altar on top of the wood. He reached out his hand and took the knife to slay his son. But the angel of the Lord called out for him from heaven, "Abraham, Abraham." "Here I am," he replied. "Do not lay a hand on the boy," he said. "Do not do anything to him. Now I know that you fear God because you have not withheld from me your son, your only son. Abraham looked up there in a thicket and saw a ram caught by its horns. He went over and took the ram and sacrificed it as a burnt offering instead of his son. Abraham called that place, "The Lord will provide." And to this day, it said, "On the mountain of the Lord, it will be provided." And what I want you to look at here is what the angel of the Lord said to Abraham. He said, "No, I know that you fear the Lord now. You are going to give me your only son, your one and only son." But he didn't. He didn't have to. He was going to, but he didn't. And God acknowledged this as such a powerful testimony of belief to him, that Abraham was going to do this, even though he didn't have to do it. And then later, God does the same thing, except for he did it. He did not spare his own son. Abraham was able to spare his, but God did not. If God acknowledges Abraham's even just willingness to do this, to show the love that he has for God, how much greater is it that that God did actually send his son, that he did not spare his son the way that Abraham was able to?
It's
already up there. God could not spare his son and still carry out his plan of redemption. God could not spare his son, still carry out his plan of redemption. He couldn't have spared his son. If he wanted to go through with the plan that he had, there was something that had to happen in order for his plan to be successful. We talked about our plans and how they were ruined by such little things, but they didn't stop our plans from happening. This would have stopped God's plan from happening, and he followed through with it, the one thing that had to happen. Going on into verse 33, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. I've got to tell you a story about my grandma. She's one of the most loving people in the world. Whenever I was a little kid, we had this thing called Livonia Homecoming. And it was, Livonia is the town that is the closest to where I grew up. And I think there was 74 people there. I don't know how many there is now, not that many. But there's way more dogs and other animals than people. And so we're at Livonia Homecoming, and this town of 74, when they gather for the homecoming, there's like 300 or 400 people there, and everybody just comes back, and it's a good time. Everybody has fun, and they throw horseshoes, and they play all these different games. We did like American Idol and all kinds of stuff. But whenever I was a little kid, I called her this morning to make sure I was getting this story right. But I take off running from her, and she couldn't remember why, and I can't remember why, but I take off running away from her. And I run like through the horseshoe pit, and I'm dodging horseshoes, and they're all flying around me. And so I get out to the road, and I start to like go across the road, and I look back at my grandma, and she's like, "Don't you cross that road?" And so I do it anyways, and she comes over there and just spanks me. And so at that point, I was like, I'm bawling because I'm 5 or 6 years old, and still would have at 14, but I'm bawling, I'm crying and crying. I'm like, "Grandma, you didn't count." And my grandma's like, "No, grandma doesn't count." And like, grandma lays down the law. But this is the same grandma that I was, oh gosh, probably about the same age. And I was helping her in the backyard, helping her with do some chores, feeding rabbits and whatever she had to do. And so I was like, "Grandma, can I stand in the back of the truck when you pull back around to the front of the yard?" And she's like, "Yeah, I don't care. Don't tell your mom." She didn't probably say that, but I get in the truck in the back, and I'm like hanging on for dear life because I'm young and I'm terrified. And so I'm holding on to the sides of the cab, and I've like got my back up against the thing, and I'm holding it. And then the door shuts, and she shuts it right on my finger. And of course, she didn't really shut the door hard, and like you couldn't even tell by looking at my finger. But I was like, "Grandma, my finger's broken." And it's like, I mean, it literally looks exactly like it does now, except, well, a lot smaller. But she was like, "Okay, well, we'll go to the hospital." And so she drives me half an hour to the hospital, and I'm just crying the whole time, and it doesn't really even hurt anymore. But But I was like, maybe we can get some ice cream out of it or something. And so we're on our way to the hospital, and we get there, and my grandma comes and brings a wheelchair to carry me back to the... And man, I'm not kidding you. So there I go down the hallway and just bawling. And I'm sitting in a wheelchair, and I've got my hand like wrapped up in a thing that grandma had for me, in like a wet towel or something. I don't remember. But the wheelchair made it feel better. And so we're going along in the wheelchair. And I think it's interesting to see the difference there. The difference in, like, when I was in trouble, grandma was, no, this is what we do, laying down the law. And then such a loving grandma that wasn't going to let anything happen to me, wasn't going to let anybody do anything that hurt me, and took me to the hospital to do really whatever I wanted to do. And I think it's a lot like that in what Paul writes here. Anyone will bring any charge against those who God has chosen. Whenever we, if we do something wrong, we're going to have to own up to it. We're going to have to repent for it. And the law is going to be laid down. But we are God's children. And he's going to love us, and he's going to take care of us. And who then is the one who condemns? No one. But Christ Jesus, more than that, Christ Jesus who died, and more than that, who was raised to life, is at the right hand of God and is also interceding for us. And you see, throughout the book of Romans, quite a few times in Hebrews also, that Jesus, although he died on earth and was resurrected and ascended into heaven, that he still is interceding for us. He still is interceding in our lives. He's not just sitting up there waiting, right? And it says that the Holy Spirit's doing the same thing just before this, and what Jonah read. There is no appeal against God's children in his court. There is no appeal against God's children in his court. Whenever you are a child of God, whenever God is over everything, really, there is no court, there is no ruler above him, right? Whatever he says goes, and that's final. So those adversaries, the people that would consider us enemies that are really fighting against us, there is no appeal that they can make that's going to make a difference for God's children. But he is just, and he will do what he needs to do. As we move on, we're going to go into verse 35, and this is where Jonah's going to take over. So Jonah, why don't you go ahead and just dig right in to verse 35.
Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword? As it is written, and now Paul references here to David's trials in Psalm 44 and verse 22, which says, "For your sake we face death all day long. We are considered sheep to be slaughtered." In 35 and 36, each of these troubles are worse than the one before. And often, as humans, we live through these troubles, and we feel like God is against us sometimes, like maybe he doesn't love us. And the truth is, nothing could be further from the truth. Paul experienced most of these things firsthand, except for the sword, which he knew would probably come. But he knows through all that God still loves him. And these are all things that mankind does to mankind. Like trouble or hardship or persecution or famine or nakedness or danger or sword. And that's not really God's doing. That is mankind doing that to each other. And none of these are really proof that God doesn't love us.
Yeah, I think whenever you look at what the psalmist wrote, "For your sake we face death all day long, we are considered as sheep to the slaughter." You look at that and you look at what Paul has written, and really, they're talking about the same things, the trials and the persecutions. They're going through a lot of the same things, and the only difference is the tone, because Paul, he's writing this with a tone that's like rejoicing, and the psalmist isn't. And I think really the biggest difference there is that Paul knows of the death and resurrection. He knows that it's happened. He knows that we have hope. He's got a hope that maybe the psalmist didn't in that time, right? Something that because he's let what happened to him, the thinking physically, not thinking eternally, that's happened. And going into 37, knowing all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. And this is the reason that we named this sermon Super Victors, because that translation literally means we are greater than super victors. Like there's a victory that's so much greater than just a victory. There's something eternal. And Paul then says, For I am convinced. And what he's saying by this is not just that he's convinced, but he says this in a way that he wants us to be convinced also. He really wants for us to just get it, to get what he's talking about. That neither death nor life, neither angels nor demons, neither the present nor the future, nor any powers, neither height nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God that is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. And so the first thing that he talks about there is death and life. Nothing in death or life. And this kind of confused me a little bit whenever I first started to research this, because all of these were all the commentaries, I guess, that I looked at were almost all of them said, "Oh, I bet you're wondering why death is in here." And I'm like, "No, I'm wondering why life is in here." That's the one that I couldn't figure out. It took me the longest to figure out, but what I eventually boiled it down to is just that things in this life is what he's talking about. Things that we're going to go through. So neither death isn't going to separate us from our eternal promise, and neither is life. And the next thing he talks about is angels and demons. And Jonah, why don't you talk about that just a second?
Yeah, I see neither angels nor demons, meaning like no beings on earth can separate us. Although angels or demons seems like they could have a pretty big impact on our faith, I guess. Like whether they're good angels or bad, they're still subjected to God. It says in 1 Peter 3:22 that angels, authorities, and powers are all submissive to him. So we don't have to worry about even angels or demons. Nothing like that can't even separate us from Christ.
Right. And then the next one is present or future. Nothing that is happening now, nothing that's going to happen in the future. We get in this mindset that what's happening to us right now is the worst thing that could possibly ever happen, right? And it's not. It's not at all. Whenever I was at State Golf, I was thinking, gosh, if I could just play good, my whole life would be figured out. And that's not true at all. But I thought that was the worst day of my life. And I've had a lot of worse days of my life since then. But nothing that's happening presently, nothing that's going to happen in our future here on earth is going to separate us from the love of God. And then he talks about no powers, which Jonah, why don't you talk about that?
And nor any powers. To me, that means the rulers or government powers. And luckily, we live in a country where we don't have to worry about persecution. But a lot of countries, if they're Christians, they do have to worry about being persecuted. But even the highest leaders can't come between us and Christ. And next thing is, nor height or depth.
Height or depth. And he's really just getting more specific as he goes down. And then he says, height or depth, nothing. Like nothing high, nothing low, nothing is going to separate us from the love of God. And then he sums it all up in the very end. Mm-hmm. And he says, or all of creation. There is nothing on this earth that's possibly going to separate us from the love of God. Mm-hmm. But I think there is one thing. If you turn to Hebrews chapter 6, and I'll read it. You don't have to turn to it if you don't want to. But it says, it's impossible for those who have once been enlightened, who have tasted the heavenly gift, who have shared in the Holy Spirit, and who have tasted the goodness of the word of God and the powers of the coming age, and who have fallen away, to be brought back to repentance. To their love, to their loss, they're crucifying the Son of God all over again and subjecting him to public disgrace. And then you move down to 11, he says, we want each of you to show this same diligence to the very end so that what you may hope for be fully realized. And there he's talking about God not being unjust that he'll be, that he's not going to forget the work, the love that we've shown. And what I want you to pull out of that is that that it is possible to fall away. It is possible to fall away. And you look into John chapter 3. At the very end, in verse 36, he says, "Whoever believes in the Son has eternal life, but whoever rejects the Son will not see life, for God's wrath remains on him." I think that the, I don't think anything can stand in the way of God's will, of God and his will, except for ourselves and our will. The only thing, that's the only thing that's going to stand against God, is ourselves and our will. I don't know where you're at this morning, personally. I don't know, you could be going through something at work, maybe. You could be going, maybe you're in the same place as Jonah. Maybe you're just graduating from high school. And why don't you share with them what that looks like.
Once you get a taste of his glory, it's hard to fall away. But I've seen a lot of times where young people who have gone to church all their lives and they've been in a Christian family that, like, once they go off to college, they may start to fall away, or they have people in their lives that didn't come from the same background that start to pull them away from Christ and their relationship. But to graduates, I just want to say, be strong in your faith and continue to go to church as much as you can. If you're going off to college, I can imagine it could be really hard to, in a new situation, maybe go into a church that you're not familiar with. But just continue as best you can, even if it's not the popular thing to do. Continue to be strong in your faith.
Yep. And there's a lot of people, a lot of people in here that aren't graduates, like everyone except for six of us. So you could be going through the same things, right? You could be, I mean, it may look like your whole world is falling apart. It may look like everything's going against you. It might even look to you like God is against you, but he's not, and we can promise you that. And so don't let anything stand in the way. If you're at work and there's somebody that's giving you a hard time, doesn't matter. It's a present thing, and maybe it's even a future thing here on earth, but it's not an eternal thing. Maybe your life does seem like it's falling apart. Maybe you're dealing with death, you're dealing with grief, depression, I don't know what it is. But it's not going to separate you from God's love. And so as we pray and sing, if you want to talk about that, if you want to maybe explore the idea of Jesus in your life, why don't you come down and talk with one of us. Father, we love you so much. We thank you for letting us gather together to talk about you, to open your word, and to digest it together. God, we thank you for everything you've done for us. God, we thank you for your love. God, we know and we trust that it will never separate us as long as we believe. We love you so much. We praise you and we trust you. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen.